My name is Herbert Wiltz. I'm originally from Bourque, Louisiana, and I presently live here in Lafayette for some years after marrying. I'm basically a retired educator in languages, mainly for French and Spanish and Creole.
I was born in the community of Bellevue in 1942. Sort of South Bellevue,
My name is Don Cravins. I was born in a small community called Mallette, Louisiana, in St. Landry Parish, in a very rural area.
I'm Patricia Cravins, Pat. Most people call me Pat. I am from Lafayette Parish, Lafayette, Louisiana. I was born October 28th, 19-something, and in Lafayette. I grew up in the Huval Street area.
Well, of course, we've always, and I've always identified as being a Creole. Not to confuse it, certainly African-American, but a Creole, very much part of our culture. Grew up in a Creole community, in a Creole family. As a matter of fact, my mother and father, their first language was French, and of course that's what they spoke to each other. They spoke English to us. My grandmother could speak only Creole, and she lived with us for a few years, and of course I was able to learn, and I guess most of my siblings, we were able to learn from her, particularly because all of her expressions were en français.
I would say that I am a Creole lady. My first language, believe it or not, was Creole. My mother and father spoke English in front of me, but it didn't matter what they spoke because I understood everything they said. They both worked. They worked, and I stayed with my grandmothers.
I am an African American who has been influenced by many cultures, many other languages as well, but primarily French. Growing up, I heard Creole in the household, and folks who visited my grandparents, whom I was raised by, they all spoke Creole.
As Cajun and Creole, and ethnically more Cajun, of course, but the Cajun and Creole families are so fused in so many ways, both culturally and otherwise, that it's really really sort of hard to pull those two identities apart. Yeah.
It's an expression, or it is part of the being, part of the feelings, part of the, certainly you could define it in terms of food, you can define it in terms of even religion to some extent, and in terms of language. But I think it's much more than that. It's a pride and a closeness to people and to the land, and I guess just an expression of all that's natural. What do we look at in people as naturally good? What do we look in food as naturally good? How do we connect? And it's all part and parcel of all of those things, and it's kind of in my mind like just a gumbo of so many good things.
You know, they were brought up with that help your neighbor, because what you do, if he can do it, you can do it, and your children see what happens when we work together.
And I think in the world of art and music and food, those are three sort of human endeavors that bring us to these places where commonality emerges. If I eat at Leo Chase's restaurant, I'm eating my grandmother's food. And if I you know, listen to Boisec. You know, I'm listening to the music of the music that I grew up listening to.
As a young child, being in that neighborhood, I lived in a neighboring neighborhood to Mr. Catalon and his family. I got to know that family well because my father and Mr. Catalon were both carpenters. And whenever Mr. Catalon had a job that he needed a good, reliable carpenter, he'd always call on my father and vice versa. Mr. Catalon took care of business. So I can remember there was one point where you did what you had to do to make a living and to do for your family. And one of the hurricanes had almost destroyed Grand Isle, had destroyed the Grand Isle that had been so grand. And Mr. Catalon kind of, he got a call and took Daddy with him. And he did the negotiations, and he and Daddy stayed on Grand Isle. They'd come home on weekends, but they'd go and stay there and did a lot to get Grand Isle back to its grandeur. That was a time when people knew they could depend on each other.
I know Mr. Richard J. Catalon Sr., possibly more through his children, because I was a teacher of some of them. But I did meet him, and we did have several conversations. And in those conversations, I guess it was an inspiration for me to continue the development of Creole as it exists, and also the culture as it exists here in Louisiana. I also belong to, and at present, hold the title of President for Creole Incorporated, which in essence, we want to preserve the Creole culture as it exists here in Louisiana presently. And that has been for some time, in whatever way that we can possibly do so. My focus is primarily language, the Creole language. And so we've had, Mr. Catalon and I had some conversations, and in those conversations, he related to me that people need to get along. People need to know how to actually listen to one another so that they can express their ideas, their concerns. It doesn't mean that this is your idea is better than mine, but that you do have an idea and it needs to be heard and presented and shared and actually respected.
You know, I didn't know Mr. Catalon. I know him in the same way that that I know Mr. Vallo from Abbeville, and in the same way, I mean, they're historical figures who are very, very important, and people who worked so beautifully to affect changes that were not the big headline changes.
I think part of being in public office, being my culture came to bear, I think, to a lot of ways in the decisions I made, in the relationships that I built, because I think it gave me the opportunity to focus on those things that I think would be most critical to people. Not so much a matter of what's good for the establishment, but what's going to better serve the people that I was entrusted to serve. And I think that's where you go back and you look at those very emotional but personal emotions, I guess, personal feelings that you share with people. And the fact that in the Creole culture, that becomes almost the center of that universe. In other words, what's going to serve our community best? Not what's going to serve the government best, not what's going to serve the corporations best, but what is going to make the quality of life for our people better. And I think that's probably kind of encapsulates what that cultural upbringing had to do with my adult life and public service life.
You know, I'm a poet primarily, and before that, I was a teacher who wrote poems. and so now I'm a poet, you know, who sort of has a teaching mission. And one of the things that I would like to leave is a body of poetry that questions the ways in which we unnecessarily distinguish ourselves or pull away from each other. You know, I have a strong conviction that, you know, religious labels and political labels, even though they serve a purpose, often pull us apart more than bring us together. And that's one of the things that I hope that my work as a teacher and my work as a poet would sort of explore the ways in which we're more alike than we are different, and the ways in which we really need each other. Yeah.
So much violence, just so much violence. I just pray and wish that each one of those kids that would need a Mr. Catalon or a Mr. Arsenault, who is my dad, Mr. Cravins, my father-in-law, would have that kind of person in their lives where they would learn to value life a little more than they're doing today.
And so with that, and many other people that I know that visited with him, he wanted to share his life stories, the things that he experienced in life as a Creole individual, as a person in the Creole culture and language. If he was able to speak with someone using Creole, then he actually did it, or presented whatever ideas he had, presented them in Creole to an audience, and they were intrigued with that. So I was glad to have met him. That inspiration continues till today. I was very, very thankful to the parent, to the family, the family members, who presented me with an award, the Richard J. Catalon Creole Heritage Award. And to date, I'm very, very honored to have received that.
Richard firmly believed that what you give is what you get. So he spent a great deal of his life giving, and giving graciously.
Nice talking to y'all. C'est comme ça, c'est faible dans ce temps. Il parle pas français du tout. Thank you.